Alright guys, to start off this week I wanted to touch on a couple of additional items related to the in-class project from last week. First of all, there were a few folks that were wanting to use a VLOOKUP in order to get these column headers transposed over into this sheet. And depending on the circumstances and exactly what, you know, what functionality you're wanting out of your sheet, that could be a perfectly legitimate approach. And some folks, yeah, were having a little bit of trouble getting that to work, but it's actually fairly straightforward. So I want to step through that real quickly. So if we did just want to set up, you know, a VLOOKUP thing to get those day labels. Now, of course, the first consideration is that we're going to be looking up these values, right, where it says column 1, column 2, column 3, column 4. So I have to keep those intact. And so I need to insert a row. I can either do it above or below. I think it makes a little more sense to do it right here. So let's just put a new row in here where we're going to come in and look up the proper column headings based off of those. And so in here I'm just going to come in, I'll put the VLOOKUP function in right here, and I'm going to look up the value that's in the cell directly above. So I just reference that cell. And I'm going to copy this to the right, and I want those to move to the right as a, you know, the column to update. So I want to keep that as a relative reference. It really doesn't make any difference what I do with the row reference, whether it's relative or absolute, since I'm not copying down. So we want to look that up. We want to look that up from this table. Starts with where it says column 1 up here. It's a little hidden on my sheet because we have this help box up there, but we want to go over, and then we want to return the value that's in the third column. Now here, I want this to be all, this is a little frustrating. I can't use my F4 key when I'm recording these videos because it does something different with the video recording software. Okay, and put dollar signs in front of all those, and then we want to return the third column, and then as always, or almost always, we'll put in the value false and hit that, and that should work fine. And when I copy that over, it should work without making any adjustments there. And sure enough, you can go back and double check here. Let's make this a little bit easier to read. Let's format that. If nothing, I'll just make it bold and center it, and let's wrap the text just so we can see what we've got. Okay, so we can use the VLOOKUP there. Now the issue is, as soon as I delete this, it's going to lose the reference to those cells. And so this is something that I do commonly enough that I built a single button to do this. There's a lot of applications where once I've got formulas in there, I've verified that those formulas are doing what I want them to do and everything's accurate, I'll just come in and I'll copy the contents of those cells, and they come back into exactly the same location. We'll come in and we'll paste special, and we'll paste values back. And so now I've got the headers in there like I want, and so certainly, yeah, we could record those steps into Visual Basic. There may be some advantages in doing that. So certainly, yeah, if you're dealing with reports that are coming out potentially in a variety of different formats, and you want to ensure that, you know, you're always getting the proper alignment between what it says here and what that value is, then it would be worth going through maybe and using a VLOOKUP to ensure that continuity. So, and then once we've done that, then of course, I mean, the reason we pasted those values back was so that we could come in then and delete that row and everything's still intact. Okay, so that's just a quick look at VLOOKUP. Now while we're talking about VLOOKUP, let me just show you, point this out. So for pretty much anything we talk about, there's, you know, innumerable other resources out there for you guys. And so one of the things that I did was just looked on YouTube for tutorials and things on VLOOKUP. I just searched for VLOOKUP Excel 2010. May not matter what version of Excel you look for. And so you can see, I mean, there's, you know, a ton of videos on there on that, I actually went through and just kind of see what it was about. Took a look at, I think, at this first one. You can, go through and find the same lesson out there. This one's fairly short. It's like a 10-minute video, and it's got some really good stuff. Goes into a little more depth than stuff that I covered in class. So that one's worth checking out. Okay, so let's look back at this HP gas chromatograph output file that we've been working with. And so far, everything that we've done, we can do by recording actions, just working on our workbooks. And I want to start taking this a little bit further now. And so let's take this scenario. We've got this particular report that we've got coming out of the GC. But let's recognize that this is only one particular layout, one particular possible layout for this report, and we may run other things on the GC where we'd have fewer outputs, or we might run one where we've got a lot more. And so we want to come in and make this a little bit more flexible. Let's make it a smart application that can come in and recognize things like how many columns there are total, and be a little bit more flexible in those regards. Now, the assumptions that we're going to make here are, first, that every report that it's going to generate, that it's going to start with column 1 in this same cell location on this same sheet. So it's always going to start in cell C3. Now, there are ways that we can identify where it starts if it were potentially going to start somewhere else, but I don't want to get into that yet. But so let's just say that we know that that cell is going to be where column 1 is going to be no matter what, but we don't know how many total columns there are going to be, or what those are going to be. And as a consequence, we also, when we get this data sheet back, we don't know which of these columns we want to keep or delete just based on their position. We're going to have to make this macro work based off of this, off the information that's in a given cell. So if, for example, if the cell has retention time in it, RT, we may want to delete it. Alternatively, we might just want to look for this, the amount in there, and say just retain those columns that have amount in them, or, well, we also want to keep the sample ID in there. So let's come back and look at this from a little different vantage point, because it's going to take a different approach. So what we're going to do is we're going to come in and we're going to start building a macro from scratch. I'm not going to record anything this time. We're just going to come in and write the code based on our knowledge of the few objects that we know about, worksheets, ranges, and some of the methods and properties of those objects. Okay, so let's go ahead and open our Visual Basic Editor. And I've got a module in here, but I don't have anything in this module yet. So let's go ahead and name our sub procedure, and let's just call this something like GC Reporter. That'll be a procedure to go through and modify the existing gas chromatograph output report, right? And one thing that I'm going to do here, and I'm not going to force you guys to do this throughout the semester, but it's good practice to get into, is we're going to start declaring all of the variables that we're going to use. And there's a number of reasons for doing that. You can read through Walkenbach, and he talks about this. It's just good programming practice, and it will force us to do some things. Now, one thing that you can do in order to force yourself to do that is at the beginning of any module, so this is before any subs have started, I'm going to come in and put in this option explicit statement, and that's going to force me to declare any variables that I'm going to use. Additionally, it therefore checks to make sure that if I've used a variable and I didn't declare it, it'll pop up an error message and tell me that. So it's kind of handy to do that. Now, as I said, I'm not going to make you guys do this, but it's as you're in playing around yourself and learning to do some of this programming, it's just good practice to get into. So I'd encourage you to use this when you can. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and indent. And I'm going to start thinking about what it is that I want to accomplish. And so I want to come in, and I guess really what I'm interested in is these titles, right? Starting in cell E3 down to somewhere. We don't know what the end row is going to be because we just said that we're going to allow that to be variable. So we have to figure out how to find that end row. And then we want to get all of this information that's on this labels page and transfer that over to the data tab over here. So first thing that I want to do is I want to declare a variable that is going to let's say one to find the last row. So we're going to have to do some procedure to come in and figure out how long this sheet is. So let me just do this. So to declare variables, we use this kind of it's actually kind of archaic language now, but DIM, initially when they came out with that, it stood for dimension, and they used it only for arrays. But now it's used to declare all variable types. And so then we're going to declare the variable. So we type DIM and then a variable name. I'm going to call this one last row, and we have to give it a type. And so here I could, and all this is going to be is just it's going to go through and identify the value of that last row. So it's really just an integer. Now there are limitations on integers. You can again look in Walkenbach, look it up online, whatever. They only go up to like 32,000 and something, which isn't a problem a lot of times, except that so this is just one of those kind of rules of thumb in Excel. If you're going to assign variables to row numbers, since we've got potentially, now I lied, but still, this is an XLS file, and so we've only got 65,000 rows. In XLSX files, we've got over 1 million rows. But regardless, it's over 32,000, so there's more rows than there are values for integers, so we have to use a different variable type here. And in this case, there is a variable type called long, which is a long integer that just goes up to, I don't know, a couple million at least. And so anytime you're specifying a variable that's going to have row numbers in it, you want to use that long variable type as opposed to an integer variable type. All right, so we'll let that be the only thing that we do at this stage. And then let's come in and start thinking about what we want to do. So what I'm going to want to do is get information that exists in a particular row and column. So let's just, I think we're in row 3, column 5. We want to get that information that's in there, maybe store that in a variable, and then have that come back over here to another sheet and insert that in a specific spot, and then step down to the next row, get another piece of information, maybe store that in perhaps the same variable name, and then loop back over here and put that information here, etc. So already we can see, well, maybe there's, used for a for next loop in here, and that's going to key off of the row number. So I'm going to need another variable perhaps that designates the row number. So we'll just call that R, and again that's going to be a row number thing, so I'm going to call that a long data type. And then we said that maybe we want to bring that value back as a the cell header information back, as in this case the variable type will be a string. That's a string of characters. You can read through, there's a particular page in Walkenbach in one of the chapters, either chapter 7 or 8, that we just read, where he gives a table of all these different variable types. And so that's one of them, is string. So now I'm going through and anticipating what variables I might need. You don't have to approach it this way. You could go through and just start writing your code, and then each time you realize, oh yeah, I need a variable here, you'd come back up to this section of your code just under your sub and declare those variables up there. But like I said, I'm just trying to anticipate, and there may be additional ones that we need that I might have to come back in and add. That might be enough to get us started here. So let's just go ahead and start getting some code in here. Now, this macro is going to permanently change information that's in this file. Some of the things that we talked about in class is that a really useful thing to start with is just to go ahead and add add code to create a copy of the sheet that we're going to be manipulating. So in this case, it's going to be this data sheet. And so I just, before I do anything, I want to keep everything intact. Let's just go ahead and create a copy of that, and then we'll do all of our work on that copy of that sheet. So I know that there is a property or method for sheets that is the copy method. So I can just designate the sheet that I want to copy. I copied it. And then there's an option within that copy method to tell us where to put that sheet. And in this case, I want to be pretty specific. It wouldn't matter a whole lot, I guess, but I want to tell it instead of after sheets 1, 2, or 3, let's go ahead and copy that and place it right after the sheet that we were copying from, right? So I'm going to, that should take care of that. Now, I said we weren't going to record things. It's perfectly legitimate, even when you're building code from scratch like this. Let's say that, I can't remember this syntax or, you know, what exactly. Yeah, I know I want to copy a sheet, but I can't remember the, you know, the object or methods, whatever. So there's absolutely nothing wrong with going in and recording a short macro while you're doing this. So jump over here to Excel and just record a new, you know, quick new macro here. Notice it popped up a new module for me, and it's going to start recording this in here. And then I just come in and say, okay, yeah, I want to copy, create a copy of that sheet, and let's move it there, see what it did, and then I'll stop recording. Okay, so if I couldn't remember that syntax, I can look here and see, okay, yeah, that, you know, I didn't need this, right? I didn't have to select it, but right here's pretty much what I did, except that rather than designating that sheet as sheet number 3, I actually designate it with its title. So regardless of where it was, it would work. Okay, so that's a, you know, good use of this tool of recording macros to get at some syntax that you might want to have. But we've already done that, so we've got that copy. So we've created a copy. Now we want to, one, let's give that sheet a different name. And by default, we know how Excel names new sheets. And if you're wondering, if we'd have any question about it, since I just did it, we can see down here that when it copies it, by default, it just gives it the name with the number 2 for the first copy. It'll just have the number 2 in parentheses after that. And I think there's a space in there. We have to get all that right. And I want to change the name of that to, let's say, report. Now notice I'm putting quotation marks around that. That's a string variable in essence, and so that should give it a, should create the copy, give it the name report, and then we can do all of our work on that copy. Now at this stage, we can test and make sure that's working. Let me back up and delete this sheet out that we just made as we were testing that. Okay, and then at any point as you're writing this stuff, you can always step through and make sure that things are working. So all we've done so far, yep, I clicked there, it made the copy, and then it renamed it. Okay, so far so good. Now, we said the first thing that we wanted to do, we want this to be a flexible application that'll determine how many different title columns we have. And so let's come in on this sheet and use this sheet to figure out how many total rows there are. And there's a really handy property of a sheet. In this case, we'll name the sheet labels. So sheets labels, and that property is the used range. And so Excel with that property recognizes what the very last cell in the entire sheet is, and that'll return that entire range. So that's what it says, it's the used range. And so with any range, that's a range object, with any range it's got a rows property, and there's a method of rows that is called count. So anytime I have any, you know, rows in a range, I can count the number of rows. So this will count the rows in the entire used range. And so we said that we wanted to define a variable that equaled that, so we'll call that last row which we've already defined up here. So I'm going to say last row equals the count of the rows in the use range. Okay, you're going to use this a lot. This is an extremely handy property to use on sheets where you don't know how many rows they're going to have and you need to cycle through an operation, you know, until you get to the end of the sheet. So I use this all the time. Okay, so we've determined the last row. So now we can set our for loop up. So I'm going to say for r, I've already defined r, for r equals some row number to the last row. So if I look over here, I can see that really what I want to start getting the information from here. So starting in row 3. So assuming that this output's at least going to be consistent in that. So from r equals 3 to now I can say last row. And let me show you something, another benefit of defining those variables. You can play with this a little bit. But since I defined it with that DIM statement above, if I type it and I don't capitalize it the same now, it will take care of the capitalization for me. So by defining those, you also help with your consistency. And then I always do this when I'm writing for next loops, is I just come down, leave a little space, come down here, and make sure I do the next R, right? So it'll increment to the next row once it gets done with whatever we put inside this loop. Okay. So now what do we want to do? We want to get the information that's in this particular cell and assign it to this variable that we've called header. Okay, so I'm going to say header equals, and now to specify this particular cell, this is where we want to use the cells object instead of the range object, because the cells object allows me to identify a cell by its row number and its column number, right? So I can come in, let's make sure that we get it on the right sheet. So this is going to be equals sheets labels, and it's in cell. Okay, so the row number now we want to be R, and that's the real trick of this whole thing, is now it's automatically stepping through values of R. We're going to identify the cell based off of that value of R. This is why range wouldn't work. There's no way to assign it like that. And we're in column 5, column E here, right? So I'm in column 5, so I want it to be the value of what exists in that cell. So I identified the cell referring back to this moving value of R. So each time it loops through, it'll step to the next line, and we use the value property of that object. And so now we've returned that to a variable. And so now what we want to do is we want to take that variable that we've stored in that variable and put it over here on the data sheet in the right spot. So now I want to say sheets, well, not on the data, right? We created this new report sheet. Let's make sure we work with it. So sheets report cells. Now, and this turns out to be quite handy just because of the particular layout in this project, but it turns out that my column number is also the same here as this row number, right? So it's column 3. So, and the first place that I'm, and it's, we're always going to be in row 1, right? We're returning these headers back to row 1 all the time. So this is going to be cells 1, comma, R. And I can say value equals now my variable that I put that content into, header. This is essentially a VBA coded, this whole for next loop with those two steps in there is a paste transpose, very specifically two cells that are in these locations, but it's a little more sophisticated in that it's going through and identifying from this sheet, you know, how many rows do you have, and then I'm going to take all of those rows, take them over to this other sheet, and I'm going to put them in row 1 in the appropriate columns. So let's test, let's go ahead and test that and see how that works. We can step through it one at a time just to be sure. Now, I'll show you another handy thing of this, being able to step through things. We've already done the first steps of this, right? I've already created a copy. I could go back and delete that report sheet and then step through the whole thing, or we can do it this way. I can Okay, I'm getting an error, and so this will be a good place for us to identify. So this, yeah, I see exactly what it is. I had typed in, I thought I typed in string up here to define this variable type, but apparently I stopped too short and I put it in there as a style type instead of a string type. So that's one of the other handy things of declaring those variables. It may be a little frustrating at first because it will pop up some of those errors, but it helps you avoid bigger errors further down the road by forcing you to define those variable types. Okay, so this should work now. Yep. Now, what I wanted to show you is when you're stepping through code, you've got control over where you are in the program. So it's going to highlight the next command that it's getting ready to execute. I've already done these two steps and I tested them. I don't want to redo that. That sheet already exists, so I'm just going to grab this arrow and drop it down here. So I just effectively stepped over those two pieces of code, and we're going to start down here and see how this works. And so it should have counted the number of rows in that sheet. I think maybe my video recording stuff is interfering with my mouse over. It should, when I just mouse over that, it should show me the value of that last row. But another way that we can get that is to come down to this immediate window. I can put the question mark in, tell it to type back to the immediate window, and just type the variable name, and it should give me the value that I just hit enter. It gave me the value of 21. Sure enough, if we come over and look at that label sheet, the last row in that used range is row 21. So it picked up that value. And so now this is going to step through from 3 to 21. So, and it doesn't matter, shouldn't matter where I'm selected on the workbook as I step through here, since I did everything specified by sheet name. It should only perform those operations in the right place. So let's just see. So we'll step through that once. Let's go to the report sheet, see if it did anything. Yeah, it put sample, the value sample up here as my column one row header. We'll watch it change as we do the next one. So just did column two. You can see it stepping through one column at a time. Okay, so you can see we just built our own, paste transpose function in here. So let's just go ahead and run the rest of that and take a look on our sheet. And sure enough, it ran through the entire sheet. Now we should probably go through and test that, make sure it's going to work for different lengths of data, data lengths. And feasibly, I should be able to come in over here and just start with a sheet with either fewer or more names and make sure that that works. I'll leave that to you. You can go in and test that and see how that functionality works. That's probably enough for one video, so I'll come back in the subsequent video and we'll look at how to identify in a smart way, how to identify which columns that we want to eliminate. So check back on the next video.